Hi, this is Jonathan. Today is December 1st, 2007, and I've actually already uploaded this video series, but I'm redoing the beginning audio intro just to try to clarify a few things that may be a little confusing to some people, because what you're about to see is going to be shocking. And I've already gotten a lot of personal emails in response to it by people that are shocked by it. And I understand that. I'm no less shocked by it than you are. It's just that today is not the first day that I'm coming into knowledge of this, okay? You know what I mean? Today's not the day that I discovered it. The day I discovered it, actually I wasn't alone, it was with another person. And we were flying off the handle. We couldn't believe it. We were just going through every magazine we could see. What I'm about to show you is how to see the visual side of these subliminal messages. You're going to see them, all right? And what I've done is I've taken the raw images of just certain things that I've found, and then did my best to trace over the subliminals, the word commands that were embedded within the pictures, and some of them are going to be shocking to you. So the ones that I put up are, I made sure they were ones that other people could see the same thing. But even then, there are going to be a few where, you know, I looked at it and looked at it again fresh the next day, because I was doing this really early in the morning, and yes, some of the letters are slightly off in my tracing and whatnot, but about 90% of my tracing is right on. And unfortunately, when I uploaded the video the first time, the quality of conversion, once you put it on this site, is not good at all. So you can't really see. So the purpose of this video is to give you a guide. Now, all of these pictures I have gotten just offline. It's real simple. You just find the picture and find the area that I've traced it in the video and just still it or put it on pause, and then just toggle back and forth between the picture and the video and look for yourself. Why am I doing this? Okay, what you're going to find is that when you start looking at these yourself, that if you really look for a long time, your eyes get pretty strained. And so your eyes can get tired, and sometimes you don't know what you're seeing. And this is just the nature of the brain, because if you've studied any physiology, you know that the brain cannot really interpret chaos. So it's always going to assign a pattern to it, which is the very basis of a subliminal manipulation. They just do enough to predict how the brain's going to organize certain cues and whatnot into images or words, and then play upon that. So what I need to do is explain to you the most important thing of all, which is, why can't you see them? And that's very important that you know that. Why is it that you can't see them? They're right in front of your face. So what I'm going to do is give you a quick lesson to show you and bring you up to speed right away. What I want all of you to do is just go get a piece of white paper. And a lot of you have done this before, and if you've done it, then you need not do it. But those of you that haven't, do this. And what I'm going to have you do is check for your blind spot. What your blind spot is it's just where the optic nerve innervates the retina in your eye. And so there are no rods and cones there to receive any input. And so you have no incoming signal to the brain from that part of the retina. However, you don't just see a void for any light that's focused onto that area of the eye. And I want to show you what you do see. So get a white piece of paper and take a pen and just make some two dots about 2.5 inches apart, and make the dot, you know, a good solid dot, like maybe at least 0.5 centimeter in diameter. And what I want you to do is to cover your right eye with your, I mean, right eye, left eye, doesn't matter, but let's just say it's your right eye. Cover your right eye with your palm and hold this paper about 18 inches away from your, you know, directly in front of your left eye, and about 18 inches away. And I want you to stare at the right dot of the two dots that you've made that are horizontal, with your left eye. So with your left eye, make sure your right eye is covered and stare only at the right dot with your left eye. Make sure that right dot is directly in front of your left eye, about 18 inches in front of you. And then slowly begin to bring that piece of paper towards your eye. And what you're going to find, using your peripheral vision, the left dot that you've drawn will disappear. And that is your blind spot, okay? And if you look at the left dot with your left eye, then it will come back. Obviously, this you have to stare at the right dot with your left eye and bring it really slow towards your left eye, and the left dot will disappear. Well, what's happening there? You're not getting any input signal, so shouldn't it just be black? Shouldn't it just be a void? That's not what it is, is it? So what is going on? What do you see? You see white. You see the white paper, right? If you're doing that right now, you see that. What that means is that you're seeing something that is not there. And I repeat that. The white area, the white paper that your brain is fabricating over the dot because you're not getting input signal is not there. You're hallucinating it. But more specifically, what's happening? Well, it's true that in life, you filter sometimes up to 50% of that which you experience with your senses, but particularly your vision and audition as well. So how does that work when you're adding things in and taking them out? Well, what I want to show you is with the blind spot, what's happening? You're not getting this input signal, but the brain's not going to leave it as a void. So you are projecting into that image something that isn't there, and the brain will take what's nearby around that dot and utilize that signal to cover up the void. Well, get this. First of all, what I want you to really, really pay attention to is this one fact. When you do this, and go ahead and do it again, take the dots and bring it close to your eye, covering one eye just like you had before. Do you feel like you're in a trance now? Do you feel like you're dazed or out of it or drugged up or under hypnosis? No, not at all. This is just a function of the brain. You don't got to be dazed for this to manifest, okay? So if you have been basically conditioned correctly, your belief system will play the same role as your blind spot did. What I mean by this is if there are words, say, and I'll show you, you'll see them, okay, coming up in the pictures, that are right there in front of your face, but they're transparent. Say they're 90% transparent, but you should be able to see them. Okay, but if your belief system says it's not there and you don't know to look for it, around every line of the word, your brain will literally filter that out, you know, in replacement for not getting the input signal, like the blind spot. In this case, you just filter it out, and then your subconscious will project the nearby surrounding input signal to that which you're filtering out right over it. This happens before the image is mapped onto the occipital lobe, okay? It's your occipital lobe where you resolve the image, and that's where you're interpreting the image visually, okay? So all this processing goes on before you get the final image in the occipital lobe of the brain. So if I put a tiny little word sex on someone's forehead and make it transparent and say it's only, you know, half a centimeter in length, in very transparent, very thin lines. If you don't believe it's there and you've been hypnotized to not see that, you'll filter it out and project the skin color and tone and everything right over it. Okay? And as you've seen with your blind spot, you do not need to feel like you're hypnotized or dazed or entranced for this to occur. All they need to do is formulate your sensory perception, starting as a baby. Do you follow this now? So a lot of people, when people are going around saying, you're all asleep, you're all under hypnosis, You're all under hypnosis. I guess they're not really explaining it effectively, so this is what I want to do. These are just almost. I mean, the belief system filtering process is so fast and so automatic that it's almost like your autonomic nervous system. A lot of it will occur in the brainstem itself, and it's called efferent suppression, and there's a coordination of this. And you don't need to sit here and learn brain physiology, but I want you to understand that very basic part because it's important, okay? So remember, there are things right in front of your face that you are literally covering up just like your blind spot, and you have gotten proof that your brain can do that with your blind spot. You follow what I'm saying? That dot is there and you're not seeing it. And it's the lack, and it's not white. Do it on a black piece of paper with a white dot. It'll cover it up with black. It'll take whatever surrounding it, even complex patterns, and fill it in. Do you understand that? Well, you can be hypnotized to do the same stuff. Literally, people. So you're going to see, what am I going to show you here? There's a picture of George Bush. And when you see what's on his face for yourself, you're going to be like, what? Okay, I didn't see that. But once I show you where it is, now you know what to look for. And this is why I'm a target, because I can break hypnosis. You're going to see it. And now the quality's not very good on the video, but those pictures are available. Just look under Google Image. That's where I got them, so you can get them there too. And you're going to see, unfortunately, David Icke and Alex Jones both have these cues and commands all over them, just like everybody else. Now, I don't really know what that means. Part of me wonders, is this just some sort of algorithm in a computer that puts it on everything? Because I've not seen live pictures, you know what I mean? Like a photo picture on paper that I've held of David Icke or Alex Jones. But these certainly have them. And those pictures, got them right off their website. So just in case it's something funky with my computer, like some sort of NSA-loaded spyware to put these subliminal commands, because I know Microsoft Windows has stuff like that. In case they put that stuff on my computer to put into every picture. And I explain more of this on my other upload. I don't want to go too long here. I'm going to lose people. Oh, you're just not going to pay attention anymore. You need to see it for yourself. So this is not me coming out and saying, hey, everybody, I'm showing you the world. What I'm saying is, hey, this is something I've noticed. There are a lot of other people that I've, you know, collaborated with in person that can see the same things. So what I need to do is get this information out, and people need, it's so crucial that people look at pictures for themselves, the same pictures, and see the same things. Why? Because there are certain, you can project, all right? Like I told you before, the brain is not just going to take in chaos. So you can project your own thoughts. Now, the more attuned you get to this, the more used to looking at this you get, the less you're going to do that, the more you break out of the trance. But you know, you can start to project your own interpretation, your own structure resolution, your own pattern resolution onto the picture. Because seriously, what you'll find the more you start looking at this is you can look everywhere, and if you want to, you can see the word sex, for example. You can freaking look at the grass and see the word sex. So your brain can pull that out. So you have to start to make sure that it's really there, and once you start to know what to look for, then you know how to filter out what's there and what is not there. A lot of people have seen it in person here, but now going online, I think it's going to be a very, very crucial thing that people start to collaborate. And here's what people need to do. It would be more credible if, say, a bunch of people happen to look at the same picture without talking to them, each other, right? And identify the same subliminal messages before they talk to each other, so as not to influence each other and say, hey, this word is right here, you know, go look at this, and then influence. Now, some of them are so obvious that it doesn't matter if you do it or not, but I think to be valid, to make sure people really know what they're looking at, the more samples we get of people saying, look, I found this, and if they start popping up and different people who don't know each other are starting to see the same thing, then to me, that's credible. Okay? And that's very important because the brain does do this. It does project, you know, like I told you before. But that's their veil, you see. They can always say that. They can always refute the argument of subliminal messages. Except for the ones that I highlighted. They're kind of obvious in a lot of cases. Especially if people start waking up, they can't do that anymore. But for the little ones, they can always say, oh, that's just an accident or you know, whatever. But for example, Harry Potter. Now, I just put one still frame of Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban. It's at 49 minutes and 12 seconds. Now, just that one frame has sex everywhere, like 12 different times. Usually it tells you to seek sex, okay? Seek sex, seek sex. That's what they're telling everybody to do. It's pretty fuzzy. I've already seen how it looks on YouTube, and it's fuzzy, and there's nothing I can do about that. But those pictures, you can find a lot of them. The Prisoner of Azkaban, I just took from a still, the movie myself. But any of you that have that DVD or that movie, just pause it. But Harry Potter movies are loaded with it anyway. I mean, for these children's movies, they certainly are promoting sex a lot. And again, how does that work? If you haven't heard my other uploads, it's pretty simple. Your conscious mind will access your subconscious mind for the meaning that you're going to project onto that which you experience with your senses. It could be a picture, an event, a scene, a concept, legislation, whatever. And what you do is you access your subconscious for the meaning that you apply to everything. Because everything you look at is meaning. Okay? Really, you should start to learn the ability to look at this world and not project meaning onto anything if you want to see the truth. But that's a whole nother lesson, and I don't have time to get into that right now. But just know this. This is what you do. This is why beauty's in the eye of the beholder and whatnot. You will filter out things that other people see and add in things that other people can't see. So, again, another reason, just another, you know, check as to why many people should be looking into these subliminal messages and starting to, you know, see if we see the same things. Very important. You got to be level-headed. I know this is crazy stuff, man. It really is. But you've got to try to keep a level head and keep some critical assessment skills going when you do this. Okay? Just understand their point of view and where they may put it. You'll start to be able to predict it. You'll start to be able to predict how they do it. Most people have no idea the extreme to which they are programming everybody's mind. The ignorant people will say, oh, well, they taught us that in graphic arts in college. No, sorry, they didn't teach you this, okay? And anybody that says they do know this and they're fine with it, they know that they're programming people in the way that I'm going to show you, and they're okay with it. Well, you make up your own mind on that one. The thing with Bono, the video went a little bit longer because I really needed to establish why they're doing to Bono what they're doing. And you're going to see this. I couldn't believe it. I had to verify it with many different people because I'm like, am I seeing things? What is this? Is this Michael Jackson all over again? What is this? Except Bono's not as weird as Michael Jackson, so it didn't. It was more abrupt when I saw this, but wait till you see what's on Bono's face on the cover of Rolling Stone 2005. It blew me away. And that one, you can go right online and get that picture and see it for yourself. And so I needed to really establish what a lot of people probably missed with U2 and Bono. That would be pretty self-evident in the video that I've made. So take a look. Make sure, again, stay level-headed. Verify the images that I'm showing you. See, you're not going to learn anything if you just look at what I show you and say, oh, that's it. Okay? This is what I'm trying to stop. You can't teach a student or somebody or anybody to learn just by getting them to, submit to your opinion. So it's very important that people try to disprove me on this. I know that sounds crazy, but anybody that's a thinker will understand why I'm saying that. I want people not to be, dickheads to me. If you find a flaw in it or some sort of variance in what I'm doing, just send me an email and say, hey, you know what? I got this picture and it doesn't quite look like that. It looks like this word or that word. And let me take a look at it. That sounds like, the way humans should be rather than ripping on each other. Now, no one send me that type of criticism yet, but and I'm not sure that I'm wrong, so I may not get it. But again, you can't learn unless you see it for yourself. So don't just look at the video and say, oh, the subliminals are there. Hey, look at this video. No. Find the pictures and make sure you can see these things for yourself. That is so important. You have no idea how important that is. It's just like the difference between real life experience and studying for real life. You know what I mean? You should know what I mean. Do not take, even though it's blatant and right in front of your face, do not take what I'm saying as fact until you see it for yourself. Otherwise, I have taught you nothing. I need to, I don't want people following me. Okay, it's not about me. What I want to do is create brains that can see. Part of that is questioning what I'm doing. And some of you may think, well, that sounds contradictory, but it's not. I promise you, it's not. You've got to question you, even me, you've got to start questioning. And when you start to see them, then you can teach others. Do you see? And it's very, very important that you learn it. You learn the ability to start to be able to assess what's been hidden from you with your own eyes. Because I don't know how long I'm going to be around people. And I can't sit around and trace these all day. I mean, my eyes are getting so tired, and doing it on a computer is not the same as looking in a magazine. The flicker rate and the shit that's in the, I don't even like to be on the computer. And it gives me a headache, and my eyes get strained, and it's just, I can't do it. And there's just way too many. But I can tell you this. I mean, I've seen this type of thing. I started looking up old paintings from like the 1900s. And these type of subliminal messages are in like Claude Monet paintings. I mean, they had an unfair advantage. Oh, I just love Claude Monet's painting. Well, yeah, because sex is written all throughout it. And you're drawn to it and you don't know why. So it's really important that you understand this is something that's been going on for a long time. And I don't know the full extent of it, but I know that the picture level is bare minimum. And you should start to learn that because it's all over the TV. And in that case, you should listen to my other upload where I bitch a lot in the beginning. But really, yeah, I do explain it a little bit more about the conscious, subconscious mind and what's going on. What else can I tell you here? So you're going to see a little bit of the pictures, okay? And then you're going to see a lot about Bono and what you two are doing. And I think that, see, nobody's come out and said anything about Bono. All right, what it looks like to me is either they decided to do it then and pulled it for some reason, or they're trying to shape opinion. And when you see what's on his face, and I won't even tell you, I'll let it be a surprise. You got to remember, subliminal messages are no different in a lot of cases than general advertising in that one exposure is not usually going to do much. I mean, the general rule is a frequency rule of 3 times before anything starts to really take shape. And the more times you get hit with the same message over and over, subliminal or not, the more solid it becomes in your belief system. So it isn't that you just look at a magazine and say, oh, okay. But if you see the same command throughout various magazines, like don't read legislation that takes away your rights, do this, do that, obey this person, don't question authority, all these things, and you see it your whole life, then yes, it does start to shape your belief system, and you have no idea. It's completely benign as far as you're concerned, and you have no idea that it had occurred, okay? I'm going to put a clip of a movie called They Live. It's kind of funny. It's a generic movie. It's a B-rated movie where you know, it's about an alien, aliens living amongst us, but you can't see them. That's not what I'm telling you right now. I'm just telling you about the subliminals. But in this scene, he puts on glasses, symbolic for waking up, that allow him to see the commands that are programming everybody, and it's quite profound. It's funny because, they do it much more simple in the movie. They make it look so blatantly obvious, but these are more hidden, and they are right there, and they are subliminal, and the commands are even worse than they show in this movie. But I think I've already seen some real subliminals in that movie. So I'm going to have to check that out. I wonder if there are subliminals saying this stuff really isn't real in real life or something. But watch this movie because it's very symbolic of what you are about to go through when I show you. So this is just a little bit of a clip here. It's a little clip from They Live. Take a look and just try to keep a level head because a lot of this is really going to, well, hopefully wake you up, especially this stuff about you too. The woman interviewing them is just leading them on, and you'll see what she's trying to discover. It'll all tie in for you, okay? I hope that you've listened this long and take a look at these subliminal messages.
Can you believe it? She didn't even go to Lamaze class. I told her, for yourself and for the baby. Go!
Did Bob make you go to John and Mary Ellen's last night?
I was shocked. She served blue corn tortillas. It's so dated.
So depressed. I don't know what to do.
Hey, go for it, man.
It's easy for you to say you got the promotion.
Look, it'll come, all right? Just don't worry about it.
The feeling is definitely there. It's a new morning in America. Fresh, vital. The old cynicism is gone. We have faith in our leaders. We're optimistic as to what becomes of it all. It really boils down to our ability to accept. We don't need pessimism. There are no limits.
It figures it would be something like this.
Our nation, our...
Well, you've always said you're disillusioned by political and religious discord. It might have been the thing that got you together and certainly keeps you going in terms of your belief system.
We're interested in division of all kinds. I'm interested in struggle of all kinds, not just political struggle, but, you know, division between the sexes interests me. Division, religion, political divide, borders. I'm fascinated by borders of all kinds.
You have always made the distinction, and a very important distinction for this band, that you're spiritual and not religious. Can you elaborate?
Religion, I've said before, maybe 100 times, religion has torn our country, Ireland, in two. Mm. So we don't feel a part of religion. I'm a believer. I believe in God, very much so. I believe in Christ, yet I feel more and more removed from Christianity when I see what it's becoming. When I see it, that they're turning faith into an industry in this country. Can you imagine what it's like for me coming from Dublin, Ireland, to the United States, a country that I love and love to play in? And I'm turning on the television in the middle of the night and I see some guy, and he's holding up the Bible in his hand, which is a book like I read and stuff. I think it's a pretty cool book. He's holding it up and he is using it to get people to pledge money, to send in money. And I can just think of old folks, they're sitting at home in their houses, they got no hope, maybe they're sick, maybe they're dying, and they're sending in their cash to this guy. And that makes me feel ill. And these people, they're nothing more than the money changers in the temple. Mm-hmm. And if Christ were here today, he'd be turning over those tables in the temple. They're the people that are destroying faith, not building it. Man, we make a big noise, and that's what people come down to see us. I mean, we're not wearing flowers in our hair, you know. We're not hippies. And even though there is, I suppose, a love in our music, there's also an anger in our music.
Even though you may not like the name protest music, you too is perceived in many quarters as writing protest songs. So how do you deal kind of with the paradox of that? I mean, you are the, you know, the consciousness band of the late 80s. Bono, you've said that you can do what politicians can't do for an hour and a half, and that's unify people. So would you expand a little bit on that?
Let me ask you this question, Rona. You don't ask these questions to filmmakers. I mean,
what it is that through a combination of circumstances, you have been passed on the mantle of moral authority. You know I'm serious. It is serious. It's the way you're written.
Really? I'm telling you.
So you would rather be seen as a broader rock and roll band with concerns?
We're just not... The difference between you two is just we're not stupid. That's the whole... Can't help it. Can't help not being stupid. Honestly, we're taking stupid lessons at the moment just so as we can go out and play some dumb rock and roll, you know?
Your fans want to be identified with you two as having a U2 kind of point of view. I read where there was a nightclub in Los Angeles, I'm sure you've read about, where they get together once a month.
Hey, that's very interesting. Celebration. They have this fan club. It's not an ordinary fan club. They're all around the country now. They don't just meet to sort of listen to U2 music or watch U2 videos. That's a part of it. But they're writing postcards for Amnesty International. They're sending off money to the third world. They're active. That's the biggest compliment you can pay U2, is to be active in your own way.
And they're made up of U2 fans.
Sure.
Edward, you've talked about being very interested in the politics of love.
Sure.
Which I think is very much at the foundation of U2. Elaborate a little bit on what that looks like to you.
To America, you know, the promised land for a lot of Irish people. And of course, we love America. We love to be here. And yet, we struggle with it sometimes, because it's worth struggling over, it's worth arguing about, it's worth criticizing.
That's cool.
You know, and even though we feel, say that we feel really close to America, as Irish people, at the same time, we kind of react and pull back when we see, you know, for instance, what America's doing to a tiny little country like Nicaragua, because as people coming from a tiny little country called Ireland, we feel very close to Nicaragua. We remember what it was like when we had the British Empire breathing down our necks. I mean, it was literally like a neighborhood bully of 6'4" bullying a 2-year-old child. That is, they're no threat to anybody. in my opinion. And, you know, I understand it's a more complicated issue than all that. Mm. You know, I went to Nicaragua, even just to see it for myself. I saw the supermarkets with no food in them because of the blockade that this country's put on. I got into taxis, and here the taxi drivers, they thought I was from America. They just called me gringo, you know. But they didn't hold anything against me as an American. They love America in Nicaragua. They love Americans. They cannot figure out Ronald Reagan. But that's the deal, you know. That's
really what the album is about, really, is...
coming to grips with America.
Coming to grips, because America's, from our point of view, is like the very best and the very worst rolled into one. But
he's got a good sense of humor.
You'd need a good sense of humor.
He's got a good sense of humor, so, you know... What we're living in this age where television, you know, can be the Pied Piper politically. That's what worries me. But it's becoming a nightmare as a continent of America is becoming an island, cutting itself off and sort of stamping on all opposition to it. And I don't believe that's the real America.
One of your songs is dedicated to Martin Luther King. Another one talks about the solidarity in Poland. So there have been some songs that pointed out some real political situations. Is that a part and parcel of your everyday life, too? You keep
up
on politics?
Part and parcel of your life, too.
Like all those subliminal messages that came from the screen really hit home in a lot of places.
I'm into it, we're into it, and I really think that the real U2 fans that have been around, they'll be into it. We might lose some of the pop kids, but we don't need them. I'm gonna go.
Breeding ignorance and feeding radiation on television. The drug of the nation, breeding ignorance and feeding radiation. TV. Its satellite links are United States of unconsciousness. Apathetic, therapeutic, and extremely addictive. The methadone metronome, pumping out 150 channels 24 hours a day. You can flip through all of them, and still there's nothing worth watching. TV is the reason why less than 10% of our nation reads books daily. Why most people think Central America means Kansas. Socialism means un-American, and apartheid is a new headache remedy. Absorbed in this world, it's so hard to find us. It shapes our minds the most. Maybe the mother of our nation should remind us that we're sitting too close to the television. The drug of the nation, breeding ignorance and feeding radiation on television. The drug of the nation, breeding ignorance and feeding radiation. TV is a stomping ground for political candidates, where bears in the woods are chased by Grecian fawns and bald eagles. TV is mechanized politics, remote control over the masses, co-sponsored by environmentally safe gases. Watch for the PBS special. It's a perpetuation of the two-party system, where image takes precedence over wisdom, where soundbite politics are served to the fast food culture, where escape keeping your mouth are more important than the words that come out of it. Race baiting is the way to get selected.
Thank you. We will rock you. We will rock you. Some may ask, why rock out now? The answer is clear. These are the times that rock men's souls. I instructed our military commanders to totally rock Baghdad. And I repeat this here tonight. We will rock you. We will rock you.
Well, I think that we just had another satellite cross paths.
Baghdad for a mom.
Allahu Akbar. That's the sound of videotape being rewound.
We will rock you. And let me say to everyone listening and watching tonight, may God continue to rock our nation, the United States of America.